Let us say there is a privileged affinity between architectural theory and technological media studies. This makes me remember my experience when teaching at Bauhaus University in Weimar, my lecture and my seminars at the Faculty of Media there on Michel Foucault's Archaeologie du Savoir and his texts like Heterotopic Places, Les Espaces Autres. These were the seminars I gave there. But those seminars were well frequented by students of the Faculty of Architecture, and I sensed already a media theory and architecture as a somewhat theoretical discipline, they are close to each other. With such experience in my mind, my talk will first discuss the notion of the machine, then introduce media archaeology as a method of research, further discuss recent concepts of the dynamic archive, and finally, if time does not run out, express the need for a virtual museum in the specific sense of a computer architecture. And special attention will be given to the sound-related epistemology of archival and architectural spaces. This current CCA exhibition in the Digital Archaeology series is about media and machines. Spontaneously, Daniel Libeskind's conceptual knowledge machines came to my mind based on the Renaissance idea of book reading wheels like Agostino Ramelli's Le diverse et artificiose machine from the 16th century. Libeskind's three lessons in architecture exposed at the third International Biennale of Architecture in Venice comprised A, reading machine, B, a memory machine, and C, a writing machine. Now, thinking about that spontaneously, Victor Hugo came to my mind in his novel, The Hunchback, you call it, of Notre Dame. The final message is that the printed book will kill the cathedral. So the Gutenberg Galaxy actually posed a challenge to architectural spaces. What is ironical in thinking about writing machines is now that exactly the printed book, which is supposed to have killed the architectural knowledge of the cathedral, returns, since printing now returns within the computer. The alphanumeric code, which drives the computer, actually is the return of the Gutenberg Galaxy from within the computer. And the irony is that to most of computer users, this secondary printing culture is not visible anymore because most users don't code computers but use the interfaces. This dissimulates this ironical return of history the more. So the interrelation between architectural spaces, the cathedral, and printing becomes open again. Far beyond the mechanic engines driven by steam or electric force, as known from industrial technology, the transclassical machines, which are the computers, have turned into symbolic and informational devices. When in early computer art manifestos, thinkers like Abraham Mohl described machine art, this was a cybernetic understanding of the machine. So we are dealing already with a really different notion of the machine. In discourse, very often machine is still related to the energy thermodynamic mechanism, but we have to radically rethink the term of the machine itself. The cybernetic approach, far from being simply to be historicized into an epoch of intellectual history, is still burning in the hearts of media archaeologists. To quote Mohl, quote, "We are presently facing a new revolution more important than the mechanized revolution that inspired Karl Marx, a revolution of automation, of symbiosis with machines, a secret revolution in the sense that those who are part of it, all of us, were unaware that it was going on. End of quote. Now, even this was expressed in the early 70s. I would quote this as a present comment. Indeed, the technological archive works at its best in a mode which is already well known from ancient rhetoric. Dissimulatio artis. The ancient Roman rhetoricians, they said the most convincing figure of speech is that it dissimulates its artificiality. And most technologies work best when they hide their technological ground to the user. The electronically implemented cybernetic information paradigm, which to the general public remained mostly concealed in its implications, was then emerging as one of the deciding factors. Hands, our human hands actually got more and more off machines by automation. From the anthropological view, the hand as tool has been both the central definition and already an extension of man. Machinic typewriting has differentiated the hands into 10 discrete fingers. Finally, the binary code reduces even the decimal fingers to 2. What still looks like a playful performative handicraft in reality is already a techno-mathematical operation. While my fingers hack such thoughts in symbolic code on the keyboard of my laptop, the media archaeological distance is aware that most writing is done within the microprocessors themselves, where algorithms reign. Different from a typewriting machine, which is still an instrument, the computer has already become what the philosopher Gotthard Günther once called the trans-classical machine. When discreetly calculating either in his mind or when coupled to a pen, eraser, and square paper, man is itself, himself in a Turing machine state. Now, diagrammatic reasoning comes in. First of all, I have to mention that the computer is not just about mathematics, but about logics as well. And I'm still surprised again and again and again that in the end of the 19th century, it was a philosopher, the inventor of the modern type of semiotics, Charles S. Peirce, who was in his thinking of how can we mechanize logical thinking, was the first to design an electric circuit diagram. So this stems directly from logical reasoning, which he called diagrammatic reasoning. This reminds of forms of symbolic notation, which are themselves already symbolical machines. As already designed and commented in early 19th century in the sketch of the analytical machine invented by Charles Babbage. Since Babbage invented his so-called mechanical notation, which was not only meant to present the calculating machine to be built, but he said, by this kind of notation, we can run the machine already. We can test the machine already on paper as a symbolical machine. So we see how radically the idea of the machine has turned from a material and energy consuming mechanism into a symbolical operation, which is the heart of computational culture. Such an operative script is itself the machine. And I call it operative to separate it from the performative. When human bodies are involved and they do work or they dance or they perform on a theater stage, this is performative. But when machines act, and machines are actors as well, I call it operative. And the computer can be defined as an operative machine because it's a symbolical mechanism which acts. Any media archaeology of digital machines in both senses, as media archaeology of the digital and archaeology of knowledge by digital media, does not simply trace back our current media condition in terms of cultural or social history of technology, but rather reveals principles and commands in the technical and mathematical sense, which are still the underlying condition of present media culture. So media archaeology is not about the first computer. Media archaeology is about the principle which drives computing. This is a slightly different sense of archaeology, which of course refers to, once more, somehow to Michel Foucault. From Foucault, the set of terms proposed for discourse analysis in his Archaeology of Knowledge is itself a theory machine, how he called it. The author takes the metaphorical expression of the archaeological machine literally. Quote, "I must discover whether the machine works and what it can produce." Actually, the computer, different from other inventions in the history of technology, has been born out of a theoretical consideration. Alan Turing's design of the so-called Turing machine, which is somehow the birth of the modern concept of computing, results out of a mathematical theoretical discussion. It was not born out of experimentation by engineers. That makes the computer so different in the history of media. It creates a new paradigm. So far in Occidental culture, narrative has been the primal mode of processing archivally stored data in the name of history, which continues in the form of timelines and stories, even in computer games, though in fragmented ways. Media archaeological analysis, on the contrary, does not operate on the metaphorical interface level, taking instead account of the fact that all so-called multimedia is radically digital data processing, undermining the separation between visual or auditive or textual or graphical evidence, which just translates data to the human senses. An archaeology of media, as the notion implies, follows Foucault's archaeology of knowledge in not looking for metaphorical uses of media in public discourse, but in reconstructing the generative matrix created by mediatic dispositifs. In the Baroque age, Athanasius Kircher's term for his machine for automatically composing music was arca. He called it arca, a term which has been used as well as the old name for archive. A Foucauldian use of the term avant la lettre, referring to the generative set of rules and material mechanisms, the active archive, which produce, in this case, the musical impression, like programming in a software such as SuperCollider today. Computer programming, the cultural force of today, is non-narrative in favor of algorithmic forms of writing, an alternative form of minimal serial time composition. The paradigm of computing itself is therefore somewhat musical. Let us understand media archaeology in the sense of a mathematical reading of Foucault's archaeology, which does not only deal anymore with the audiovisual or textual, but with numbers as well. Just like at the very origin of the vocalized Greek alphabet, the single letters were used for numbering as well, and even for musical notation. It was all done in the same alphabet. So in the way the innovation of the Greek alphabet and its multiple use in Greek times anticipates what alphanumeric coding is today. Academic discourse in the humanities, we have to admit, is still primarily based on the narrative transfer of knowledge. The computer reminds of an opposite option of communication. The philosopher Leibniz's dream was to communicate by mathematical formulas in symbolic language the characteristica universalis. Friedrich Nietzsche, another philosopher, once mused upon the close relation between mathematics and nature. Quantum physics calculates nature by mathematizing it. Nature, by media technological measuring and calculating devices, is almost seduced to reveal its mathematical essence. In fact, now numbers have developed a technoculture of their own. Whereas Pythagoras in ancient Greece once saw integer numbers as harmonically embedded nature, the computer literally numbers the world algorithmically. Closer to mathematical Fourier analysis of vibrational events such as sound, light, heat, electromagnetic fields, than to any metaphysical ideology of cosmic order. The dominant link in the Occidental history of knowledge between the spatial optical regime and epistemological insight, let's take for example the visual metaphor of theory, comes from theorein, which means something like it's related to the view, to the insight. It's all very visually related. Now, this tight knowledge of the visual, of evidence, another visual metaphor of knowledge, is nowadays being replaced by the numerical sublime, that is mathematical calculation in time. And this, I would say, is implicit sonicity and not visual anymore, but I will come back to that. Media archaeological aesthetics is close to mathematics. In alliance with George David Birkhoff, who at the Congress of Mathematicians in Bologna in 1928 delivered a lecture proposing a non-philosophical mathematical measure for aesthetic value as a ratio between order and complexity, anticipating Claude Shannon's mathematical theory of communication from 1948. Philosophers like Max Benze, as well as artists, made cybernetics and mathematics converge. Human culture does not lose but win by such a non-human challenge. Let us be suspended from subject-centered interpretations for a moment by media archaeology, while at the same time admitting that this techno-aesthetic ascetic approach is just another method to get closer to what we love in culture. Media archaeology exposes the technicality of media, not in order to reduce culture to technology, but in order to reveal the beauty of the techno-epistemological momentum in culture itself. Beyond classical structuralism, post-structuralism pays specific attention to the time axis, that is the chronopoetics of algorithmic media. Such a time-critical form of media cultural analysis asks for a shift from traditional philological competence, literary hermeneutics, for example, to techno-mathematical analytics in the best sense of digital humanities, both in terms of hardware and of software. Now let me talk about archive textures. Architecture refers to its physical building materialities, but as well to its structural conditions, the archae. This is known from computing as well, which is both symbolical code, software, and physical implementation to actually make it happen. This requires hardware. The very term technology itself reminds of this split ontology. There is the hardware, the techne, and there is the logical mathematical principle, the logi. Both a regime of logos and techne. Technology is not only the science of techne, but the logos, in terms of algorithm, has been implemented in the material world itself. Archive, in Foucault's sense, means structure. Not to be confused with the actual record office, which is always plurale tantum, archive. I'm glad that I'm here in Montreal. For a moment, I might switch to French, parce que the archive in English, in French, is les archives, toujours en pluriel. Foucault, il écrit l'archive en singulier. Et par ça, il indique une autre notation, une autre meaning of the archive. So that's, I think, the biggest misunderstanding of Michel Foucault's description of the archive. People mistake it with the existing record office, which it is not. The archive has a more structural meaning for Michel Foucault. Since the Canadian Center for Architecture invited me to present my specific concept related to digital archives and archiving, allow me therefore to be site-specific in terms of the Canadian context. It was Marshall McLuhan's intellectual teacher Harold Innes who once developed in Toronto his pre-media theory from his research into the economical history of Canada, such as fur trade. The Carthage paradigm, Canada somehow against Rome, which is or was the neighboring American empire, stemmed from a privilege of transmission over storage, or rather networking with nodes and staples, which are intermediary storage. But the emphasis is on transfer, not storage, as expressed in monumental architecture. Innes later differentiated between space-based and time-based empires. Canada would relate to the latter one, the US to the rather space-based Roman Empire. This allows for a direct ahistorical short circuit between Rome and ROM, the read-only memory, the name for the imperial order within computing. This brings us straight to the heart of the current imperial order, the New York Stock Exchange, which figures in the current exhibition as the virtual trading floor command center designed at the end of 20th century by Asymptote Architecture. The purpose of this virtual environment was to visualize real-time numerical and statistical data, detect suspicious trading activity, and track the impact of global news event on the market. What figures here centrally is the microtemporal moment, which deserves different forms of becoming visualized, or better, even sonified. Just like earthquake analysis nowadays is better done by audification, since the human ear is most attentive to microtemporal changes, which we all know from musical listening. So what is the temporality of architecture, or the microtemporality of architecture? First of all, architecture is associated with endurance. A building is not simply there, but endures in the purest sense of temporality. It has been in the context of kinetic art that the medium specificity of architecture has not been reduced to its static building material, but has been extended to the energetic forces it struggles against, like wind pressure and most of all the Newtonian laws of gravity. In that sense, every architectural material form is necentropic, while every articulation of digital architecture is entropic in the sense of Shannon's information theory. Architecture as material building still lasts, not only in the material, but as well the temporal sense. In fact, time here is the channel of slowness of transmission. The notorious case of architectural reconstruction with computer-aided means is coming from Germany, for example, the Baroque Frauenkirche Cathedral in Dresden, which had collapsed in result of bombing in World War II, and since for decades remained a ruinous memorial. What has been called archaeological reconstruction by the responsible project leaders has since created the impression of time reverse against the essential characteristic of historical time, which is material entropy. Historical physical time tends to make structures dissolve. That's the thermodynamic law of time. That leads what buildings collapse into architectural ruins, and those ruins even dissolve into an equal distribution of stones. In Dresden, the so-called archaeological reconstruction of the bombed church ruin was in fact a media archaeological one supported by IBM calculating machines, reconfiguring the remaining building bricks and stones into the core of the reconstruction, and now it has been built on that, rebuilt on this basis. Most archaeological artifacts and buildings from the past are in ruins, just like any archive is primarily a set of gaps and absences. But computer-simulated rooms have established links, unities, and coherences wherever the factual state of the collection consists essentially of lacunae, of gaps. Now, computer simulations may close up those gaps, say in the famous IBM action, to quote another case, of computer projecting the ruins of the Abbey Church of Cluny as a virtual reality. But while media phenomenology is mostly concerned with the phenomena displayed to human senses, there is parallel reality at work which is hidden to the visitor to be critically discovered by media archaeology, which is the algorithmic, what I call the algorithmic infraphase, as opposed to the interphase. Virtual archive textual reproduction produces a data record that has never existed before. The ruin, beyond its imaginary completion, which is normally done by historical imagination, is also stored in symbols or algorithms. Each stone, whether preserved or simply presumed, has entered an objective structure, an archive structure. So I play with the double meaning of architecture, which has become a digital archive structure that makes it addressable according to its dimensions and characteristics. Each stone is both a fetchable data record and a fetchable procedure of its playback. Computer simulations do not merely form user interfaces, they actually constitute a museum. More precisely, a museum that, as in ancient Alexandria, also functions as a library, actually a library of software, that has not gone through the modern split between text and images, libraries and galleries. But a radical alternative to the dominant visual metaphorics of virtual, that is computer-generated reconstructions of past architecture, is their oralization in an act of ahistoric representing. The current CCA project, Archaeology of the Digital, not only remembers the influential architects that have experimented with digital tools from the early 1980s onwards, but also opens its collection activities to the archivistic processes, which with acquiring, storing, interpreting digital media, thereby developing the expertise, knowledge, and skills to deal with this new generation of collection objects. From that derives a specific option for the digital media archive, the Media Theater and the Signal Laboratory, which means public open access experimentation with new algorithmic tools of archive textures. The archive is here not only the thematic data set, but turns out as a hidden agency itself, an active archive. Experimentation is study in the field of possibilities defined by constraining laws or by an algorithm, a definition which is more in accordance with Foucault's logical notion of l'archive rather than with the traditional notion of archives as record depositories. When textual or audiovisual content of archives becomes not only alphanumerically addressable, but as well can be processed by operative algorithms, new options of mobilizing the inherent information become possible. I have been reflecting upon the increasing temporalization of the archive, which has previously been considered rather as static, leading to the theorem of the dynamic and algorithmic archive. So the archive is not this immobile storage place anymore, it has become itself dynamic. But let me be clear, I'm not celebrating this as a liberation from traditional boundaries. This would be politically and otherwise be naive. The opposite of the traditional archive is not the unarchive. There is still l'archive in Foucault's sense, which deserves to be addressed in its more than ever rigid, non-discursive, non-debatable structure. Structure is the archival essence per se. Against overall virtualization, let us insist on architecture in its material sense, which nowadays encompasses a new class of architectural objects, which is the new micro-architecture of computing machinery itself, as expressed in the literal von Neumann architecture as a term for storage programmability. All of the computers you use, in what forms, whatever it is, they are still based on what the engineers call the von Neumann architecture, and it's not by coincidence that the structure of the computer hardware software configuration is itself called architecture. So this is the real virtual, the non-virtual archive within any kind of virtual architecture. The new kind of archival tectonics is the revelation, the opening of the computer and its source code architectures itself. Therefore, we switch from the computer-based representation of architecture to the architecture of digital computing itself. There is a veritable information architecture standing behind the current forms of digital communication and internet usage, consisting of several well-known layers. It is such information which needs to be archivized, since it usually does not enter social and cultural memory on the discursive explicit level. The term tectonics itself is known in archival science already, but will be given a new meaning. According to the online glossary of the Swiss Federal Archive, for example, the term archive tectonics, which is a technical term, is defined like this. Archive tectonics describes the hierarchical structure of an archive's holdings. The Swiss Federal Archives contain various description levels, main departments, top level, fonds, subfonds, series, dossiers, and documents, the lowest level. The archive plan search in Swiss archives displays the archival tectonics in a hierarchical tree structure. So we discover in archival theory and practice the word tectonics itself. And I compare this to the computing architecture, and it's not by coincidence that these are all architecture-related terms being used. So why not take them at face value when addressing the computational archive? This is the symbolical order as architecture of the archive. So a future theory of the archive in digital culture reactivates a concept which was once named by the medievalist, the historian Ernst Kantorowicz, for the Renaissance theory of power, well known as the book The King's Two Bodies, because there are the archive's two bodies. There is, on the one hand, that most of the records we know, textual, audio, visual, they become digitized. So there is a digital duplication of the archive. But at the same time, this all has to happen within the most physical, still 100% physical hardware. And so the archive, the digital archive, is always both. It cannot be reduced to the virtual. And it's this insistence of the hardware which should be addressed in architectural terms. So what happens to places like a museum at the digital frontier? Let us switch from the technological archive as condition of digital culture to the museum as its media theater. What is required is an extension of the notion of the museum in digital culture. This does not simply mean computer augmented museum space or virtual museums or imaginary museums, like you find lots of them now when you go online. Computing itself, both in terms of hard and software, becomes a possible object of museum display. And there is a good reason why we need the museum, since the computer cannot archive itself. The computer can do almost any other thing, but not archive itself. That's why we need museums, to reflect upon computing. Virtual reality is a possible way of allowing us to enter the architecture of digital media themselves. Therefore, it is the structure of such archives and not their metaphorical representation which might become the real focus of architectural museums. Now, I'm a bit too late to address this because the International Congress of Architecture Museums just finished yesterday, anyway, here at that place. Let me propose a new decipherment of the acronym CCA, Canadian Computer Architecture. The notion of computer-aided design, CAD, turned inside. Turn the current exhibition, Archaeology of the Digital, Media and Machines, upside down. The fundamental issue is that the computer cannot show itself while being in operation. What we see is just the metaphorical interface level. But open hardware computer teaching models show themselves not performatively and metaphorically, but as truly operative media theater. An example is the vintage Z1 computer, which was based on electromagnetic relays for each bit. And it was rebuilt by the inventor who invented it during the Second World War, Konrad Zuse. It was rebuilt in the 1990s for the Technical Museum in Berlin. And I quickly show you how that looks and why I actually see that close to architecture. Here we have students in the 1990s showing how the Z1 computer, which is the earliest German programmable computer, works. It's electromechanic, and you see it's drawn by hand. The clocking of the computer, it's four cycles per second. And the computer itself is completely transparent. There is no interface. The keying of the computer, the input, is made directly into the machine. You give the dynamic element by drawing this wheel, because the difference between computing and mathematics is that mathematics happens in time as computing. And now the computer itself displays itself as a dynamic architecture. That's the point of this demonstration, and we can have a more closer look at the storage unit. Once more, we see why it's not in a metaphorical sense that there is a dynamic architecture at work here. So this is, and what I show, this is not a group of architects who create algorithmic architecture. It's the computer itself which is algorithmic architecture here. And my third short clip shows you this. You hear the computer, and here it's presented as its spectrogram, as the analysis of its sounding, because the sound analysis of the rhythm of the computer gives access to its essential functioning. And all of a sudden we switch from the visual metaphors to the acoustic, to the ear as the sense organ, which can analyze the temporal mathematics which takes place. So this gives more direct access to the computer. Now this goes even further, how to do this architectural analysis of the computer. I show you quickly an effort done by the Aperture Labs. They managed to visualize even the data records kept on read-only memory chips by creating code to extract data from the read-only memory. This looks like quickly like this. You see how this is how magnetically, or in terms of condensers, how in a ROM data are being stored. It's a grid structure. They are addressed on the X and Y axis. Now, what the Aperture Lab does is they have managed a way. Yeah, I just to identify magnetically by magnetic resonance and detection the program which is stored there and reconstruct from the physical memory of the single bits the programming, the program and the code behind its computing. So this is an act of very close reading forensic media archaeology, which goes into the architecture of the computer. Here it's a storage component, takes it literally and identifies the code. That would be sort of architectural and analytics as a media archaeological act. So the chip itself, and we are talking about opening the computer chip, which to most people is just a black box. But if you open the computer chip, it has a highly defined, analyzable structure. And the chip itself is using and displaying its architecture. And in this case, it's assembly language which has been deciphered. And the instructions in the ROM can be destroyed. That I would propose as a kind of media archaeological digging into the computer architecture, conceived as architecture itself. So, and where is the place to perform such operations and to show this to a more general public? To a public which is used to the computer, which has been flattened to the interface itself. Nowadays, with the extreme maximization of minimization of computer technology, people don't experience the computer at all anymore. The interface and the computer become one with the ultra-flat computers. So the more it requires to show what is the architecture behind, to remind people of the both material and logical structures, which is the power which governs our digital culture today. And all we can do is to archive such knowledge. Computer architecture museums would have to store state diagrams, hardware architecture, and software solutions, and store them so precisely as to preserve at least the validity of mathematical algorithms. Because where are the other places in culture which take care of storing such information? That could be a primary task of an architectural museum in the new sense. But this has to be done as executable program instead of passive reading, which poses a challenge, of course. As long as the digitalization of most museums is still reduced to the focus of the multimedia dreams of making things more user-friendly, the new museum just builds up interfaces for the new reality of digital archive, but the examples which I have shown might give access to a different understanding of the computer architectural museum. Digital archiving could break up the alliance that the museum has maintained with traditional history or even historicism in the last centuries. And even the chronological sequence as the empties of all kinds of order in which stored things are usually put in museums could be replaced by an order of co-presence once their combinatory connections are located. And even more radical is the media archaeological approach to discover the informational value from within the objects stored in an archive or museum. So we have the histograms of digital images processing to calculate its entropy, or we have spectral analysis to decipher sound archives. So suddenly we have a new kind of archive which can interpret the archival records from within. Once things are being digitized, you can analyze every bit. And this allows for the fascinating and frightening possibilities of big data, which allow to navigate in the digital archive in new ways. And I think the National Security Agency, the NSA, is the most advanced in developing such algorithms, and they should radically be made public to show that they can be used for other cultural uses as well. The profiling of faces, which is being done, as we all know, are the recognition of voices, could be well applied to image and film and sound archives in creative ways. Between the classical museum and the virtual museum, as a function of computer simulation of architecture, there is the media archaeological artifact. Computers from the early time of electronic and analog computing, which were as big as rooms, thereby literally accessible, up to the most, to opening the most minimal condensed microchip. I remember in the German museum, the Technological Museum in Munich, there is the UNIVAC computer, one of the earliest electronic computers. This is so big, I was allowed to enter the computer. I could walk inside. You could open a door and suddenly you are within the computer. Now, to do this in a non-metaphorical way would be the challenge of a new kind of museum exhibition. I quickly show you a quite inventive, what I think is could be inventive. I check it in Google. It's to access, how to access a 2-bit, there it is. How a computer game engine is used to show how you can enter the computer. Minecraft. Now here, this has been developed to show a two-bit central processing unit of a computer. And I'm not saying that this is the future way of how a museum of architecture should display the computer, but one thing is clear, here architecture is the main metaphor to give an idea of how a computer is constructed. Let me finish with a few thoughts on architectural sonicity. Listening to computer architecture with media archaeological ears. Only by oralization, architectural spatiality can be experienced by the ear, which is based on time-critical impulse response rather than by visual perspective. There is implicit sonicity in architectural silence, a kind of sounding in latency, like a Gothic cathedral waiting for the organ to fill it with acoustic reverberations. The traditional sonic experience, not only in architecture, but in real archives, of course, is silence, and we are supposed to be silent in archives. And archives are associated with the idea of coldness and silence. Historical imagination only hallucinates voices of the dead here. The media archaeological ear, how I call it, on the contrary, is trained to actually stand archival silence, gaps, voids. But silence itself can become part of the archive. The software for sound analysis, Audacity, for example, actually provides an algorithm called Silence Finder in big sound data. That's a fascinating tool. That shows actually how the new aesthetics of navigating within the archive has already entered public software. The sheer endurance of periodic frequencies is a Bergsonian time which passes. While an empty space within a painting positively endures this time, silence in acoustics is always a temporal, though negative, event itself in its sonicity. Still, there is not only implicit, but as well actual sound from the media archaeological archive. When an ancient data set, you remember those audio tapes which were used in early computing for Commodore 64 computers, for example, when this was being loaded from external tape memory into the read-only memory of such a Commodore console, we could actually listen to data music. What we could hear and still can hear is not sound as content, It's not meant to be music. But we listen to the sound of computer memory itself. That is a software program which is scripture, but as sound. We are listening to the data archive, which is not sonic memory, but sonicity. Let us therefore, in a Möbius loop-like reversal, turn the sonic notion of the archive, and I want to say the archive has a sonic dimension, upside down. Since far beyond simply algorithmically rocking sound archives, there is an implicit sonicity in computational architecture itself. Computational space can be made viable not only by metaphorically wandering through the inside of technical computer architecture, as we have just seen it. Let us rather pay special attention to the sound-related epistemology of archive textures, which are spaces not in terms of physical rooms, but rather close to what Marshall McLuhan structurally once termed acoustic space. And I come to the end by saying, if we transfer the sonic analysis known from concrete architecture as architectural acoustics, if we transfer this to the flat and condensed architecture of digital computing, the sound we can experience is of a different kind. Since the essence of digital computing is the temporalization of mathematics by media operative algorithms, we have to change the sensational mode from the visual to the auditory mode, which is, for humans, the substitutional time organ. We don't have a time organ as such. We don't have a time sense, but the ear functions as a substitute time organ because it can notice the slightest temporal changes more acutely than, for example, the eyes. Usually, high-performance computing is not being associated with music, unless we remind of Yannis Xenakis' stochastic music, which originated from his concern with architecture. But there is an implicit music within the computer, the rhythm of algorithms. In order to become operative in the real world, mathematical algorithms, which as such are just symbolical code lines, that is a form of alphanumeric text. But in order for such an algorithmic notation to become operative, and that's what we associate with a computer, it has to be implemented in real physics. Usually this is electronic elements. And then this mathematics is endowed with temporal agency. But when it becomes temporal agency, it suddenly shares the central characteristic with any musical and sonic event that it happens in time. It's time signals and it's time symbols here. If the true message of virtual architecture machines, as we see them in the exhibition here, is that architecture wants finally to become processual. Its true archive, which is its driving algorithms, might be displayed to our time-critical senses of hearing, and then algorithms might display their rhythmic structure of the computer architecture itself. So with this sonic vision, I end at this point, and I'm looking forward to a critical discussion. Thank you for listening.
Thank you for all this beautiful exposition of a paradigm shifting, I think. Could you, on the website of the CCA, add the PDF of this lecture? Because this has to be re-read and re-studied quite specifically, I think, because I think it's very, very important. All this sonic thing, I think we're already into it. Everybody's plugged, you know, on their iPhones and everything, but I mean, they still have to live into something. We're not living in tents anymore. We're living in buildings, we're living in cities, and I would like for you to explain how I understand all the concept of digging into this sonic structure, which is very important. Actually, can we go as far as saying we can analyze a human voice and learn something about the structure of the brain? Okay, so there's much to explore there. I agree with that. But I mean, how do we fit this into keeping this into a building that still will, in people's mind, resonate with traditional architecture, because we're going to have to live into something, okay? So how do we keep the something that's above our head right now, okay, without shifting the complete name and concept of the founding of this place?
Mm-hmm. Well, the shift would first of all be to acknowledge that the experience of real architectural space, that space itself can be seen more as a function of time. In, for example, I speak now in the microphone. This serves as an amplifier, and this fills this space with sound. I experience here this room as a temporal function, as a sort of slight delay, the slight echo, the reverberations, they take place. This is my experience of this architectural space. This is the sort of, I see how much architecture is, even in many expositions at museums, and is reduced to the visual. I would strongly advocate a more sonic understanding of architecture, which has a long historical tradition already. But my argument, of course, was to say, now this happens within the computer again. That's why I want to say the computer is architecture in that sense again, and it can be discovered sonically as well. That was the construction of my talk, to sum it up once more. That it's not enough, it's heroically enough for a museum or for space to show how architects experiment with computer and create new architectural objects. But everything is then suddenly being transparent, but the computer itself, the computer hardware and the computer software. Now, to exhibit, to open, to make a critical display of computer hardware as the condition of all those experiments, maybe somehow easier, because we are dealing with real physical objects. They can be displayed. That's the traditional strength of the museum, to deal with material objects. It's more difficult with software, with algorithms. How do you display? How do you make sensible software? Because unless you are talking to computing people who know how to read it, many people don't know how. But how do you make transparent the central archive of today, which is the algorithms? And my play on algorithm and rhythm was just a hint that the algorithms in computer are always computing, they are performing. Computer is a media theater. And this temporal process, which is the essence of the computer, this temporal synchronization, this temporal orchestra which takes place when lots of data are being configured, and the computer is like a conductor, he has to organize that, otherwise that would be just noise. The auditory sonification or oralization or could be a way to give us an idea of this, the temporal sense of algorithmics. Whether this is metaphorical or artistic, or whether this is structurally rigid, would be another debate. But that's why I rather prefer to talk about sonicity than about sound. I mean by sonicity, I define as the all things which are temporarily happening, they are sonic in my definition, even if we don't hear them. But the sonic, like in, for 2,000 years, for temporal processes, music has developed the vocabulary like resonance and delay, and all those things have become technical. That's why technology is so close to sound and music. And I try to be not metaphorical about that.
Hello. Yeah, that was a great talk, and as the previous questioner said, like, it would be great to get a paper version of this so we could digest it properly. But anyway, I don't have a question about the archive necessarily, architecture, but you made a comment about Innes that I would like you to clarify. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So you referred to his Staples theories, and you sort of have mentioned before as well that he sort of sets up the classical opposition in communication studies between transportation, storage, or transmission and storage. And then you said that, and I don't know if I got this correct or not, that he sort of preferences transmission, and you talked about this being the networking of nodes and staples being the storage. Hmm. So could you just speak a bit to this notion of staples being a storage medium, please?
Yeah. The fascinating analysis made by Innes was that you can divide empires and other systems, bureaucracies. The one is more storage-based. They want to last for a long time, but they are less mobile, like the Egyptian pyramids, and they actually last. They give a long-term memory, but they are not very mobile. And on the other hand, you have something like the Roman Empire. They could administer such a huge territorial space only by fast communication media. They need light paper. You couldn't carry pyramidal stones with heavy inscriptions from one end of the empire to the other. So this was more time-based in terms of space conquering. Normally the archive is associated with an enduring long time staple, like record staple, like and most traditional empires have built big archives, like the state archives of today too. But we are living more and more in a media age of permanent transmission and permanent updating, and so the storage fixation of culture is more and more transformed into temporal immediacy and temporal transfer. I discussed it with one of the archivists here in the house when we were comparing the old archive of photographs, which is down here in the basement, and they still last, those photographs, and the old records last. Whereas everybody who knows the digital artworks which are exhibited now, to the effort to archive them, they will not last for 100 years. A medieval piece of parchment as a record can still be read. And we all know that digital data, depending on the operating system, will not last more than a generation. But now comes what is happening. I think in the present, our society has accepted that we pay a price for what we win. What we win by being online, by being connected to the internet, we get access to a huge amount of information at an instant. This is a luxury which no generation had before, that we can get access to textual, visual, auditory, social, whatever knowledge, at the speed of an electric instant. This is a marvel, this is a wonder, this is a privilege of this generation. I think consciously our culture knows the price is that this knowledge will not last very long. That's a huge transformation of our cultural self-understanding. Knowledge has been designed to last. There were big dictionaries, there are libraries, there are museums for objects. The idea of culture, at least in the Western context, I would say, has been very much based on the idea of enduring memory. And Now we live in a generation where we see we replace that by an increase, an explosion of accessibility on the price that there is no place to store it, to preserve it for a long time. It's as if the architects who have created those digital algorithmic works which we see in the exhibition already, they know this will not enter a long time history for technical reasons. But our culture accepts it. Everybody knows how long our digital records last. And we have computer crashes and we see how things get lost. We accept it because we know what we win by this computational network system is access, immediate access to a vast new horizon of knowledge and communication. But this is a radical transformation of culture. So from storage to transfer, this shift, we live now. And this has consequences for the concept of the archive, for the museum as well. And the museum has to decide, should they counter resist? Should the museum say, we concentrate on the materiality of things, that would be very much against the digital archive, because the internet and the computer information space can deal with everything, but not with materiality. You cannot order a material object you can order it by internet, but you cannot send it in the internet. And sometimes when I talk to museologists, I give them, my advice is maybe a bit surprising for a media archaeologist, but to say, count on the material object. Don't try to be a virtual place. Don't rival with the internet. You have the competence as a museum to cope with the material things, and this gives you a privileged, singular competence which you should make strong. And my idea of this architectural, now this computer architecture museum would be that this is the only place to reflect upon the both the software and the hardware of computing as well. You can do within virtual space, you can reflect upon software, but you cannot, the computer cannot reflect its own hardware. The only way the computer reflects its own hardware is when it crashes. Now, this is a complicated. This is a complicated answer to the Ines question. But to sum it up in one sentence, the current shift from emphasis on storage, preservation, archive towards immediate transmission, but immediate loss as well. This is happening now, and I'm using terms which were developed by Innes, which are still useful.
I was recently on an archive looking at all these works, and the archive website itself going to all these external links, half of them were broken.
Yeah.
And the ones that weren't, like you were saying, this it both goes out of date in aesthetics and the way it is, or it becomes something that people, becomes a trend that you go back to, and it comes back with the hardware. And that's part of it that kind of, I feel like it kind of needs to be together to looking at the archive. It kind of goes with the specific device or whatever hardware went with it at the time. One thing I was looking at the video you showed at first, remind me of studying taking apart pinball machines, and you can kind of see in the architecture the behavior of the machine. Whereas when you look at a microcontroller, it's less tangible to see the inner working, less doesn't communicate itself as well. So one way of kind of showing archiving these behaviors, both for software and hardware, a lot of times it becomes through another level of computing of interactive media, like here showing MaxMSP with the two microphones, showing the behavior and what the program kind of does, and even trying to make it tangible, then you're putting another layer of programming, you know, real-time programming on top, which when you kind of trying to show these behaviors or archives like show the working of program through more programming, that's where it kind of becomes complicated for me to think about. I was wondering if you, because I mean, even the Minecraft thing that you showed where you go into this 3D thing, you know, it's got, you're putting another level of, and watching it on YouTube, it's just, there's so much, you know, so many things mixed in that it's like, well, what would be an ideal way of making something tangible, communicative, not just to a programmer or computer science, but without making it more complicated?
Yeah, but that would be the challenge of a museum exhibition, because as long as you're reflected with computer means within the computer, then you are in a systematic circle. And how to create a distance, because distance is necessary for criticism. We need a criticism of algorithms, and there is of course software criticism as a branch of science, and it's a very important movement, software criticism. But this is for the computer literate people. They know how to read the code, and but how could this be made more tangible? I don't know the answer to how to display the algorithm in a museum, because it would not be enough to print out the code and to project it to the wall in super big letters. That would miss the operative part. But maybe the museum outside the computer to show how does this alliance between mathematical symbols and materiality take place, which is the computer? You have both. You have the material and you have the symbols. How do they interact? And that could be, one should be inventive of how to experimentally, visually, sonically, however, make this relationship the topic of a display of algorithmic criticism, which the computer cannot do itself. And that gives extra possibility and strength to that. That should be the new museum, I think, to try to find out about this. Yeah.
Hi. Just thinking about how we were discussing that it's inevitable that there will be a lot of media that seems to just run out and flow into some sort of a obstruction, but just that gets lost. I'm just thinking with consistent growth in media convergence, for example, the book that the CCA has published in relation to the exhibition, how do you think that the documentation of these media forms that would otherwise be lost, for instance, in your own book, you've documented work. So now they've moved. Do you feel that there's a malleability that's allowed for this sonic architecture that can be documented, and who should be documenting them if that is the case? And is that a veritable sense of archiving these materials in a new form?
Well, first of all, I would defend the book as a form of documentation, because you have to break the logic of computing itself by switching to another medium. The critical distance cannot be gained from within the medium, then it would not be a real critical distance. It would just reaffirm. The printed book, how old-fashioned it might seem, is a way of having a look on computing from outside. And it's apart from the fact that it's a brilliant conservation medium. But what is the reason why I come here with a text which was produced on this machine, but I print it out. In order to get distance to my own text, I need this old cultural technique of scribbling into paper, have a sort of different dimensional access to it, and have a work with it as a paper machine. This is a paper machine. When I prepare, or I finally prepare this lecture, is a paper machine, because I'm feedbacking with my own mind in a way. But in a material, this paper is like, in a McLuhan sense, and it's an extension of my mind, but it's a materialization, and this allows me to handle it in a way which is not mindful. This operation, to answer what you propose, to resist the media convergence, to switch back to the difference between media. I see the art in the art scene, in the media art scene at the moment, you see a big nostalgia of using again old analog media for musicians, composers, to switch back to electronic machines suddenly, to produce a signed tone on an old synthesizer. This is not just nostalgia. This is, I think, a clear diagnosis, a symptom of the fact that the computer proposes that it can emulate everything, but we realize more and more what the computer cannot emulate. And all the experimental media archaeology is very much about experiences which you don't make if you digitize a photography. Today when I saw the photographic archive in this house, I asked for the oldest photography. And then I was lucky that I was presented a daguerreotype from 1839. I congratulate your house that you have such a vintage thing. Now, one thing is clear. First of all, we are not used how to adjust our eyes to such a thing. The daguerreotype, you have to look at it in a certain angle, otherwise it looks just reflects lights, and you have to look at it in a very special angle and to try out. And then one thing is clear, you could never digitize the appearance, the aura of a daguerreotype. This medium, it's a chemical medium, chemical physical medium, preserves a temporality which cannot be emulated by the computer. And I think we are now entering a time when we see where are the limits of computing. In the most strictest physical sense, in the mathematical sense, and in the aesthetical sense. So, and in order to criticize the computer, we it's useful to switch to other media, to switch back to other media. But I have to avoid to. I don't want to sound nostalgic. We have in Berlin media studies at Humboldt University. We have a collection of dead media, the Media Archaeological Fund. But it's not meant to be nostalgic then about the analog days. It's rather to remind, first of all, students and visitors that even computers media are still all about materiality. Second. Most of what's happening within the computer is just minimized familiar technologies. It's all electronic materialities. And from that, we can start to ask what is the difference between the analog and the digital, and to see the radical escalation which takes place. Now, if we really would ask, well, this would be another, that can be not the topic of this talk tonight, but. We easily say digital media, digital archive. What do we mean by the digital? And what separates the digital from other media? That would be more tricky to. That would be a big task to answer that, since that would change our whole sense of history in such a radical way. The digital is ahistorical because you can copy symbols and preserve their essential originality. That's different from an old daguerreotype, which you cannot easily copy. We lose, when we really say we really want to enter the digital archive, we have to be prepared that we have to pay a price, that we come to an end with our way of thinking about time in historical terms. And that's a big challenge. That's one of my favorite issues, actually, that we are trained to think about time, emphatic time, in historical terms. And the digital decouples us from the familiar historical time, and we enter a different time culture. And this is such a big issue because we are so much temporal beings, and our cultural semantics is still so much historically influenced to enter this new language of time, but now that will be a bit the topic of my talk at Concordia tomorrow, that we have that we might be training a new vocabulary of expressing and thinking temporal processes in a non-historical way. And this new language we are not yet used to. And media help us to develop this new language, and I hope theory will help to express it verbally. And then suddenly the archive becomes more important, because the archive is a non-historical place. It is used to as the basis to write history, and it's meant to be preserved for historical memory. That's all the rhetoric. But the archive itself, first of all, it's radically present, always. There is nothing past about an archive. And the way an archive is structured, there is not narrative, there is nothing. It's open for different recombinations, reconfigurations. It's radically symbolical, it's radically digital, because we have discrete information. And that's why if you really go to an archive and give the archive the chance to be read as an archive, you are liberated from history for a moment. And that's an interesting, and you are in alliance with computing more. That's a fascinating, that's why the word archaeology plays with the archive as well. Archaeology of media is an alternative to history of media. And it's closer to the archival temporality than to the historical temporality. But this is a big issue, because history is such a dominant model of thinking about time, and I want to liberate you, and I have been training myself, to be suspended from historical thinking, to be open to think other time figures. And but that is another topic. Yeah, the comparison between the musical score and the source code in computing is an interesting one, and it connects to the question of how we experience this temporality. Most of us, if we experience a concert of a Beethoven symphony, most of the audience probably at that moment does not experience as an historical piece, but has an immediate experience although cognitively we know we are separated from Beethoven by two centuries. But different from other cultural objects, music is meant, that's why most people go to concerts. They don't want to have a museum experience. They don't go there because of a museum experience. When I listen to Wagner music, it's not because I love history, because something resonates in an ahistorical way. So what is being achieved, the musical score, although we know it's implemented in material bodies, human voices, again and again and again, and they die, and the score can be copied identically, and it's able to, by that, it's able to, against historical decay, preserve something. That's the power of the symbolical code. We can still crudely, we can still talk about Plato. It's 2,500 years which separate us from Plato. And with all the problems of how truly the text was transmitted, but it's a cultural, ahistorical wonder that we can talk about Platonic dialogues at all. We have them. Why? Because the phonetic alphabet allowed a coding of thought and language in a way that could be copied and copied and copied. And even if some copyists made some mistakes with some words and so on, but it's a highly, highly probability that it can be transmitted, and it is. That's completely different from other cultural products of ancient Greek, which we don't have an idea, and the archaeologists find some things, but and we don't know how to interpret it, and this has been lost and transformed. But the symbolical code beats history. And this happens with the musical score, and this happens with mathematical knowledge, the Pythagoras. And even one of my favorite examples is the Pythagoras experiment with the monochord. He used this one string instrument. He didn't use it as a musical instrument to produce a sound, but as a measuring instrument. He was one of the first media experimentalists. He used the one string monochord to experiment harmonical mathematical relations. You divide this into halves, and then you listen to the octave, which is being produced. Now, the miraculous thing is that this law of Pythagoras can be rehearsed today with exactly the same result. Although the Greek culture, the kind of thinking, whatever is historically very much different from nowadays thinking. But if we are coupled to a technological medium, the medium behaves the same. The string behaves the same way. That gives us the possibility to time tunnel the distance which separates us from Greece. So with techno-mathematical media, and the monochord in this way is some sort of analog computer-like medium, that gives us access to a kind of knowledge which does not depend on historical relativity. Now, I find this amazing. It looks natural, but it's amazing. There is something about the symbolical code, which is time, which is invariant towards the historical change, and that is why the musical score is so interesting. It's a different question of whether we should not confuse it with the sound. The sound is embodied. The sound always depends on the embodiment, and this always differs from the instrument, and the historical performance culture in music knows it. The sound happens physically and depends on the physical embodiment, whereas the musical score is in a way trans-historical. Now, the computer is both. The computer is both symbolical notation, but it has to be embodied. So it's the computer is both historical and non-historical. That's why I quoted the King's Two Bodies. It has this both historical and not historical aspect. And that's why the digital archive is not just a question of historical heritage. There is something ahistorical in the digital archive as well. And one of the favorite points I like to discuss with my colleagues in media studies is when you do an emulation of an old computer on your new one, which for computer games is very often the case. Most of them, you don't use the original, but you use an emulator. Now, it's not called a simulation, it's called an emulation. Is the computer then, is he just pretending he is the old computer, or is he at that moment the old computer? I think that's the new challenge of the emulation paradigm in computing. I would say there are good arguments to say he's not pretending to be the old computer, but essentially at that moment he is the old computer. And that's different from other cultural objects. You have a Greek sculpture, and most museums would say, well, this is the original. We can do replicas, but that is not the original. But with computing, since it's a mathematical, theoretical machine, the essence of computer, in the Turing sense, can be preserved, even if it's embodied in another hardware. So there I see the glimpses of a different temporality to which we might get used, and which changes the concept of heritage, cultural heritage, and dependence on historical time. But we are just beginning. I think we are just beginning. We all use computers, or this is already the second generation who uses the computer. But we have just started to conceptually digest what it actually means. And maybe we can now, because it has become a mass medium, now start to reflect that something more fundamental has changed with the computer than just a speeding up of memory and of communication and socializing. And it has changed. It's starting to change our sense of time, and it's starting, and it deserves to be rethought in its epistemological knowledge basis. But that's my task as a media theorist, to consciously reflect about that.